Across the country, thousands of farming families work tirelessly around the clock.
Stop arguing, girls. Give over.
But there's one day each year when they get to leave the daily routine behind.
Right, here we come, Dorset.
There are 11 native pig breeds in this country. Their future survival is dependent on the farmers who keep these rare bloodlines going.
Never got roped, don't you?
Nick and Guy Kiddy and David Fieldhouse both farm pedigree large whites. In a few days, they'll be showing them at one of livestock's most important events, the English Winter Fair.
Lovely.
These farmers want to promote the breed, but more importantly, it could help them build a stronger future for their farms. Just outside of Leeds city centre live David and Lindsay and their son Beau. Theirs is not the usual farm setup. As well as farming, 32-year-old David has another demanding job. He's a full-time builder.
It started 2007 with a build inside of him, plastering and tiling mainly. Since then, it's just grown.
Building brings in a much-needed salary while he establishes his herd of pigs. But juggling two jobs like this can be exhausting.
To carry on going the way I am, I'd burn myself out. You know, it's going to have to be one or the other. So hopefully in the next few years, we can say that we're actually pig farmers. Until it starts earning the same as what the building side of does, then we'll transfer across.
His interest in farming, as is the case with so many, comes from his own family roots.
As far as I know, it's my great-granddad who kept pigs, but he always just kept them as more hobby. Same with my grandfather, and my dad then took over from there, and he then started showing. And I always had an inkling that I wanted to do it, but at a young age, there was everything else going on, you know, you're going out with your friends and stuff like that. It was only in the last 10 years, really, innit?
Yeah.
That I've actually been like, right, this is something that I want to do.
If you'd have said I was going to marry a pig farmer and fall in love with pigs, I wouldn't have agreed, put it that way.
It's David's childhood memories of his granddad's farm that fuels his passion to create the same for his family.
Every weekend, like summer holidays, I was just there. You know, whether we was off going to shows, it was just the environment that you wanted to grow up in. There's woodlands, there were fields to go out and camp in, and obviously the livestock was there as well. So yeah, best part of my life spent down there.
It did wind down. When his grandfather died, they kind of... you stopped doing anything then, didn't you, for a while? So you restarted back up with your dad.
Yeah, we literally wound it all the way back to just three pigs, just so my dad could just keep an interest in it.
It isn't just any pigs that David's interested in.
A lot of people don't realise that large white pigs is on the decline. And it's more rare now than a Gloucester Old Spot, which everybody knows about, but not about the large whites.
And also we could try saving some of the rare bloodlines that are just, they're almost wiped out, really. It's almost like a heritage, really. You know, my grandfather's done it, my dad's done it. I didn't really want to see it end.
Without his own farm, David had to rent land outside the city, travelling there and back twice a day to look after his pigs while also building takes its toll.
It's tiring at best.
if I looked at the hours a day, it'd scare me. There's days and you're thinking to yourself, why am I doing this to myself? But you're just working towards something. So I just have to get on and get it done, really. Otherwise it won't get done.
Dave is one of the hardest working people that I've ever met, and his dedication to the pigs is unwavering.
Then 2 years ago, along with the arrival of baby Paul, things got even more difficult.
We were renting some land, but unfortunately that came to an end. At that point, Dave was talking about kind of giving up the farming.
Hope arrived in an unlikely form. David was a pig farmer with no land, and he was about to meet a landowner with more pigs than he could handle. He just happened to be the local butcher.
I ended up actually working for the butchers just part-time for a little bit of pocket money. So that's when I entered into a conversation with Anthony, the owner, about the fact that we'd lost the land and we were scaling back, and Dave was considering giving it up. And at the same time, they'd just had the litter, and I think they'd realised that it wasn't as easy as it looked.
The first time we bred any pigs, soon realised that I didn't have really the time or the knowledge to do the breeding myself, but I wanted to get the good quality, high welfare pork for us. So I spoke to Dave and it seemed like a perfect partnership, really.
How are you?
Good, how are you doing?
Yeah, not too bad. How were the pigs this week?
Really good, yeah.
The butcher threw David a much needed lifeline.
He had a similar kind of idea about animal welfare, good breeding, and he was really helpful when I bought my first pigs.
Anthony, the butcher, has rented David 12 acres of land, but it's 35 miles away from where they live, and David travels there and back twice a day. This is a farmer committed to building a future.
We're up at 5 o'clock in the morning to get up here and eat while feeding them, check this house to make sure that there's no ailments. And then from there, once I'm happy with everything, that's fine, it's off to work. And then back home on a night, see to the livestock again and feed on the night, and then get home.
He's always an hour late for everything,
yeah,
because he's busy doing the pigs, or one of the pigs needed serving, or just saw this.
I always think I can fit everything in.
Yeah,
before
you can.
Yeah,
I mean, that's the one thing about moving them to Ripon, is it's an extra 2 hours drive a day at least. But you've just got to accept that's part of it. And
yeah, it's
the early mornings, the late nights, it's a brilliant lifestyle.
And 50 miles south in Bedfordshire is Nick and his father Guy. They bought their farm together just 10 years ago.
I think we're quite a good team, but yeah, of course we have disagreements sometimes. It'd be impossible to always have the same opinion, wouldn't it?
Sometimes it's called progress.
The Kiddie family has an impressive agricultural lineage.
Family's been involved in farming probably as far back as we can go. Certainly my great-grandparents were farming, and we know we've got relations further back than that. And it's all sorts of farming. You know, the family's always been mixed farmers. They've always had arable and livestock.
It's no surprise that such a rich heritage would rub off on 34-year-old Nick.
Any child, you know, he's brought up on a farm, he just loved being around the animals, you know, cute little the lambs or the piglets or chicks or whatever it may be. And, you know, you play in farms and in your bedroom, and then you just can't wait to get out there and play it with the big stuff, with the proper stuff. So it's just, yeah, what lads want to do, I suppose, play with tractors.
But the reality and demands of farming life is not child's play.
We own 10 acres, and then we rent arable land and grassland in the area. So there's about 180 acres altogether. We've got sheep, pigs, cattle, poultry, and then we grow arable crops, mainly wheat and barley. But all the arable crops we grow is for pig food.
Unfortunately, despite all their hard work, the farm doesn't provide enough to support them and the rest of the family. So they've opened up a small farm shop to sell their veg, their eggs, and of course, their pigs.
A small farm like this, you've got to do things like this. You know, by selling the meat ourselves, we're cutting out the middleman.
Guy believes having the pigs in the field is nature's own advert.
You know, they drive past, they see our pigs out there and think, you know, I can go and buy one of those, and I've seen it grow, even if it's from a distance. It's really important that we show that we really do care about our animals and how they're looked after, and we try to do the job right.
But even with the shop, times are tough.
We couldn't be here full time. It's just not financially viable for all of us to have a living out here. You know, at the end of the day, you still got to pay the bills, you know, that sort of thing, and food on the table. So, yeah, the farm does a certain amount, but you still have to work as well.
So Nick has to work on a farm in the neighbouring county.
My other job is I manage a beef unit, which is pedigree longhorn cows, in Hertfordshire. It's a quite a large business. We run about 170 animals. That's my, I wouldn't say 9 to 5, but that's 7 till 5. That's my job, and then, yeah, and weekends as well.
Nick's dream of returning full-time to his own family farm is driven by the pride in his pigs.
Hello, girl.
They now own the oldest herd of pedigree large whites in the country.
Quite an achievement. I think my grandfather would be amazed if he knew.
And they have the family records to prove it.
This is the herd records in this file, right back to 1944 onwards, really.
Yeah.
Yeah. And modern records, of course, are all on computers, so it doesn't take so much space.
No.
Most pedigree breeders in the 40s, 50s, 60s showed their pigs as a way of advertising what they were doing. As the pedigree industry has sort of almost disappeared now, there's only, you know, relatively few people doing it in this country. But those of us who do it still show, you know, to promote what you've got, because anyway, other breeders in this country can see your pigs.
For both, showing their pigs is still a very serious part of their business. But for Nick, it brings out some primal instincts.
Yeah, I really don't like to.
No.
Don't like to play your own trumpet or anything.
No,
but,
no.
No, yeah, we've been doing it a long time. You know, I'm quite competitive. I like to win. You know, it's eyes down, looking at the judge, and you're trying to get your pig to show itself off the best so you can get that prize.
It's all worth it, though, because winning prizes means their pigs are sought after.
We've sent them as far, Falkland Islands is the furthest they've gone, but we've sent pigs to Japan, Taiwan. Pigs really do fly.
Back in Yorkshire, David and Lindsay also have dreams they want to realise. For them, it's all about raising free-range pigs.
We was always told about, you know, to respecting the animals and, you know, the animals came first. So I'm wanting everything to go free-range so that we can give the best for them. They aren't with us that long. It's only 6 months until they're really finished. So if we can do the best we can for them and give them the best life we can.
They now have a herd of 50 pigs, and they can become very attached to them.
They're just, they're somewhere else. I mean, they can be stubborn, but they can also be affectionate. And they're like a big dog, really, you know. They're friendly enough at times.
However, these young farmers' ambitions go beyond pet pigs. Their future now relies on becoming successful free-range breeders.
We aim to breed all year round, for us to just do it seasonally, like you might do with cattle and sheep, we still have to feed the pigs in between. So we need the cash flow coming in all the time.
What Dave's just doing is, when he's pressing on her back, it's seeing if she's coming into season.
But Lindsay is a bit more than a pig patter. She's been to agricultural college and likes to lend a hand.
If one of the pigs is struggling to give birth, I'll get a phone call. I need your little hands, and sometimes I'll have to go in and help deliver, which can be rewarding but can also be incredibly daunting. But it's you can't leave them in distress, so Dave's got hands like shovels. So if I was a pig, I wouldn't want him helping them either.
David and Lindsay's free-range future begins with the piglets getting a good start in life.
Come on, you guys. What's the matter? What? Come on. You just bring a smile to my face. Hiya. What? What?
Most farmers would be laughing at me talking to them like children, but how I feel. But I think, you know, we've discussed at length kind of like the ethics behind farming and things, and nothing we do is without reverence and without a lot of consideration. Dave's putting a lot of hard work into giving them the best possible life, so for us, we're conserving the breeds, we're giving high welfare, and we're doing our best. But I say we, I'm not doing anything. Dave's doing his best. And hopefully the pigs appreciate it.
Back in Bedfordshire, Nick's competitiveness kicks in as he's selecting the best pigs to take to this year's show.
Wait, go on.
There's fair pigs.
It was the dirtiest one as well.
Yeah.
This one's going to be going, the one going to the show, just for his shape really, and he's just a good length pig. He's got a bit on his shoulders, perhaps a minus, depending on the judge on the day. And the other thing is he's a boar. Some judges don't like boars, they like gilts in the at the fairs, so it's a bit of a risk taking a boar, but I'll take the best pig.
Choosing the best pig is one skill. Being able to give him his first bath is another.
Yeah, just give him a good scrub down. He hasn't been washed before, so we'll see how it goes. But just hot, isn't it?
It's warm. Should be about right.
Yeah. Oh, you're burning me.
I'm not worried about you. I'm more worried about the pig.
Lather them up. All right, mate. He's just missing his mates a little bit. So yeah, he'll have to be washed a few more times before he goes. A bit dirty still. Quite crusted in a little bit, so that'll be his first bath. We'll give him a rinse off.
Now for a bit of piggy talcum.
Right, the other thing we put on, something called wood flour. Just basically really fine sawdust. It helps them dry off, so they don't get cold. And it also whitens them up a little bit. Not much, but it does help. So yeah, so it looks whiter now, but it just covered the dirt up.
Both of these pig farmers are struggling against the odds to keep their farming dreams alive. Showing their animals will not only boost business, but also give them a much-needed day out from the endless hard work.
He's a good girl. He's a good girl.
David's father will be driving his pigs to the show tomorrow.
I'm proud how he's built it up. He's doing very, very well in that respect. He's building his numbers up, and he's very passionate about that, very passionate.
Look at my feet. Look at your white feet.
I'd like to see him expand a little, you know, more and get a decent living out of it for him and his family and my grandson. And
there's just time for a final pamper before he bids farewell.
It always makes your life easier if you can handle them. They're not pets.
In Bedfordshire, Nick and Guy are ready to get their clean pigs loaded.
Right, boy, time for a ride. Yeah, it's good to have a go and see how we do against everybody else. There we are, you've got lots of straw in there. Come on, in you go. I'm staying here to do all the work.
Yeah, and I'm going to have a good time.
It's finally time to head off to the show. Staffordshire's English Winter Fair may be set in humble surroundings, but it is one of the most important livestock shows in the Midlands. Dating back to 1850, it attracts farmers from all over the country. They come here to prove their livestock is the best. As well as the judges, there will also be butchers and auctioneers here today, all looking for the finest animals.
We are encouraging improvement in livestock through competition. So people want to win, and to win, they need to breed the best.
Whilst the pigs sleep peacefully, it's an early start for Nick.
So yeah, we're here, it's 6:30, so we're just going to get the pigs weighed, ready for the show, and then we'll get them washed, we'll get them fed, and pen all sorted. Then 9:30, showtime.
Before Nick can take his pigs into the show ring, they need to be weighed.
Weighed 63.5 kilo, Nick, that one.
63.5?
Yeah.
That one's in. Next one.
The weigh-in allows stewards to ensure pigs are in the right classes, with porker class being lightest and bacon class the heavyweight.
64.
Yeah. Nick's pair tipped the scales in the porker class. Being so closely matched will stand him in good stead in the ring.
You know, the 0.5 kilo out for a pair, which is I'm quite happy with. So, means I'm doing something right.
David's father, Ron, has also arrived early.
I know what I want. Willies. My willies.
He's on pig prep duty, whilst David does the feeding rounds back in Leeds.
Morning. Come on. Come on. Come on. Breakfast. Come on. Wakey, wakey.
Whilst Ron and his son's pigs have their breakfast, Nick finds time for a cup of tea and a natter with one of the stewards, Tracy.
Right, that's the one with sugar.
Thank you, my love.
That's the one without. All right,
thank you very much.
See you in a bit.
Okay,
you know where it is when you want another?
Drop a rum in it.
Yeah, should have brought some, it's freezing. The show people all help one another out, don't we? We sort of routine together, where we'll start in the morning, somebody will muck out, somebody will wash. You know, and it just makes it then a whole team effort rather than you're doing your own pigs and you're on your own.
Yeah, everyone helps everyone out, and then, you know, all go for breakfast and then all go in the ring. And then
get serious.
Get serious in the ring. Heads down, no mates then, it's like dog eat dog.
Yeah.
But,
and then it's back to friends again.
Yeah, as soon as you get out of the ring, it's time for a pint and a chat and a... Why did the judge do that?
The sun's well and truly up, and Ron's going to have a go at pig bathing. Seems his son has left him all the good jobs.
Oh, is that nice? Hey? Yes.
The farming community spirit is a heartening one. You can always rely on support and a friendly neighbour.
Hello!
Have you got loads of hot water?
No, I think you've used it.
I haven't used it!
I like to blame somebody.
I fetched my own.
Is it nice now? Eh?
Lingin. This is the beauty prep.
Nearly there, ladies, nearly there. Now that'll dry you up, won't it, eh?
With the hard work done, there's just enough time for Ron to get himself ready. Son David and the family arrive after a 2.5 hour drive.
It's been a bit of a mad dash, but looking forward.
He's always, he walked in at 10 minutes before he wanted to leave the house. And then was going, oh, come on, we need to go. And I was like, you still say. Typical.
Everyone's here just in time, as the judgings are about to begin. What's important about this show is that, unlike some others, it's about judging the animal from field to fork.
It's been a show that has been going on for a long, long time. It's got a huge heritage, huge following. We're really catering for the farming and butchery industries, so there's not a lot of general public here. We've got classes for sheep, pigs, and most especially cattle. We've also got classes for carcasses. At the end of the day, you can see what the finished animal looks like.
With all the farmers having prepped their live and not quite so live stock, the competition is finally ready to kick off. First into the ring is builder David and his father Ron. They have their heaviest pair in the bacon class.
Do you want a board?
Yes.
These pigs weigh in between 11 to 14 stone. It's taken a huge amount of effort to get ready for the show, and impressing today's judge is paramount.
I'm from a background of farming and from the meat industry. Don't know anything else, only just done this job all my life. I will be looking out for good pigs with good loins, good hams, good shape, you know, full of meat, just a little touch of cover of fat, exactly what the butcher wants. This is be the show, you know, approaching Christmas, that they would all very much like to win. So yeah, very competitive out there. We can just have these, just squeeze, just so.
Wrangling a pair of pigs is a real skill. David and his dad are doing the best they can. It's a blue rosette for David.
Thank you. Cheers.
A very respectable second place against tough competition.
That was good, yeah. But I'm happy with that. Stiff opposition, but came out with second. They showed themselves really well.
It's hectic, but we got through it.
Even Bo wants to be part of this first triumph. He is, after all, the reason David is working so hard for their future. Across the massive shed, judging is in full swing. With almost everyone here a professional, the pressure is really on. Over in the pig section, the spotlight is now on Nick. His dad is looking after the farm, so he's bringing in an extra pair of hands to help.
I'm here on my own, so yeah, Grace has kindly offered to help me today.
Grace is well versed in all things pigs. Her mother and show steward Tracy has encouraged her love of these animals since she was 3.
She's what we call a pig expert, so pig whisperer. Hopefully.
Pig say that because he probably won't do what I want for too long.
Go on. Wakey, wakey.
Nick's got some clever tricks up his sleeve to keep his pair focused.
So, yeah, we haven't fed these this morning. So hopefully in the ring we can bribe them with a bit of food to go where we want them to go.
Hopefully. Touch wood.
We'll see.
Fingers crossed, Nick's plan to keep them peckish pays off. It seems the pigs have other plans. Nick and Grace need to get them under control to stand up to the competition and show them at their best. Getting them side by side and standing still is not as easy as everyone else is making it look. Finally, Nick and Grace get them to calm down.
That's it. Right, okay. Yeah. All right. Lovely, thank you. Yeah, he's had his look. We'll see what he does in a minute. Just wander, just to have another little, just wander around. I said, Grace.
It seems Nick's lively pigs have brought the judge back for another look.
Here we go.
All right.
Congratulations. All right, Grace, thank you very much.
It's first prize to Nick, a success straight off the mark.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you.
His desire to win and the hard work he puts into it has paid off.
That's great, you know. Not what I expected when I came, so I'm really happy with that. Makes the early starts worthwhile. So. Yeah, no, well done, Grace. She's a pro.
Did you win?
Yeah, won the pair.
Ooh, get you!
The British Pig Association was established in 1884. Their secretary, Saunders Spencer, saw the need to keep a record of bloodlines. There were three founding breeds registered. Amongst them was a large white called Hollywell Jimmy, and Miss Emily, a middle white, and a Tamworth. Saunders Spencer shipped them around the world for breeding. All the purebred pedigree pigs at the show today can trace their ancestry back through the herd books established over 130 years ago. Today, the large white in the UK is on the decline, which is why our farmers are keen to promote the breed.
There's only 350 large whites and 300 large blacks. That gives you an idea of the sort of scale of the rarity. The only reason those pigs survive is if people keep them for a business. They have to have a place in farming. They have to have some sort of marketplace. And these winter shows, that's what it's about. It's about pigs that people are going to eat. It's about interacting with butchers. And so that's why it's a very important part of our tradition.
As the day continues, the fair is busier than ever. With everyone trying to push their best animals forward. It's a chance for David and Lindsay to take a break.
Say now, man.
And find out how their carcass entry has done in the competition.
We've got a placement. You can see from here how many carcasses are in. So to get even a placement at fourth, I mean, it's not what you want, but it's still a placement and we're happy with that.
Coming fourth against dozens of other entries from around the country is a great achievement for this full-time builder. A chance to see so much competition gives David great insight. The future of their business relies on his ability to produce free-range pork that the butchers will want to buy.
I was saying to Lindsay where we can improve for the coming years. We know what we've seen with the carcasses that we need to improve a little bit on the eye muscle and stuff on the carcasses, so it's all positive, really.
Outside, the winter sun is beginning to set, but inside the show ring, the competition is heating up. Nick's already chalked up a champion and first Rosette. Now it's the final chance to add to his tally.
Now we're going to move on to the singles shortly. So I've got that one single in there, and then we'll be taking one of those champion pair out too, which, to be honest with you, is probably the one that behaved the best, because the other one was a bit mad. You ready?
Once again, he calls on the highly skilled pig handler, Grace.
Look out, James. Look out.
They each take one of Nick's pigs in the ring, meaning he doubles his chances of a win.
Find out, please.
Grace looks at home as usual, keeping her pig focused on food, whereas Nick seems to be part of a merry dance. A pig tango, to be precise. The judge inspects Grace and her calm pig. Casts a long eye over everyone and their animals. It's a busy ring full of potential prize-winning pigs.
This is a very tough call.
It is, isn't it? Very.
Right. Okay.
The judge has made his final decision.
And second. There we go. All right. Thank you.
Ever professional Grace wins second place. There are two more rosettes to be awarded. Nick could scoop a double if he lands a place.
There's one more coming this way now.
There we go.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Fourth place. Not a bad result for someone who spent half their time dancing around the ring.
Yeah, really pleased with that. Every pig we've taken out has been placed, so yeah, really happy.
The English Winter Fair has been a successful day for both farmers.
Yes, I'm happy, very happy. We've done well. It's been a very successful day for us. It proves that we're doing something right, and we're heading the right way with our pigs.
Yeah, if you said at the beginning of the day I'd have a first, a second, a fourth, and a reserve champion, I'd have bitten your hand off. So yeah, really happy with that.
Cheers.
They have won rosettes and the esteem of the judging professionals.
It's very inspiring for me to see the effort that these guys put into looking after their pigs. I have to say that I said before that I get a lot of satisfaction and pleasure out of it. But of course I don't have to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and feed pigs and then make sure I get home before it goes dark. It's the people who actually look after the pigs. Those are the people that really are inspiring.
For farmers across the country, the showing season is coming to an end.
We'll keep pushing forward, keep breeding the pigs, keep, you know, trying to find that perfect pig, and, you know, we'll keep coming out and see what we do. But, yeah, we won't stop. It's addictive, so just carry on.
It's been a full-on year of a 24/7 workload.
It can be a lonely old job farming sometimes. You can be out on your own for hours, days, weeks on your own. So, you know, it's good to get out, see people, catch up, have a good chat. We're like a load of old ladies, really. We like a good old chat, any gossip, and, you know, just have a few beers tonight and summarise the day, I should think.
Hard work and commitment is all worthwhile when the farmers see their farms heading in the right direction.
We want the idyllic life where you're in the countryside.
You've never got a rug, don't you?
And seeing Bo grow up having a time rather than doing two jobs. And I think that's part of the drive as well, is to get that so that I don't miss out on him growing up.
I'm very proud of him. He's, you know, he's done very, very well.
Yeah, well, obviously we'll be cracking up in the champagne, but...
he said he's going to go home and plaster the bedroom. That's what he said. So, you know, that's a celebration for me.
Yeah, maybe not so much for me.
Romance is a little bit dead, but, you know, when the extension's done, life will resume.
Across the country, thousands of farming families work tirelessly around the clock.
Stop arguing, girls! Give over!
But there's one day each year when they get to leave the daily routine behind.
Right, here he comes, Dorset!
There are 11 native pig breeds in this country. Their future survival is dependent on the farmers who keep these rare bloodlines going.
Never got rope, don't you?
Nick and Guy Kiddy and David Fieldhouse both farm pedigree large whites. In a few days, they'll be showing them at one of livestock's most important events, the English Winter Fair.
Lovely.
These farmers want to promote the breed, but more importantly, it could help them build a stronger future for their farms. Just outside of Leeds city centre live David and Lindsay and their son Bo. Theirs is not the usual farm setup. As well as farming, 32-year-old David has another demanding job. He's a full-time builder.
It started 2007 with a building inside of him, plastering and tiling mainly. Since then, it's just grown.
Building brings in a much-needed salary while he establishes his herd of pigs. But juggling two jobs like this can be exhausting.
To carry on going the way I am, I'd burn myself out. You know, it's going to have to be one or the other. So hopefully in the next few years, we can say that we're actually pig farmers. Until it starts earning the same as what the building side of does, then we'll transfer across.
His interest in farming, as is the case with so many, comes from his own family roots.
As far as I know, it's my great-granddad who kept pigs, but he always just kept them as more hobby. Same with my grandfather, and my dad then took over from there, and he then started showing. And I always had an inkling that I wanted to do it, but at a young age, there was everything else going on, you know, you're going out with your friends and stuff like that. It was only in the last 10 years, really, innit?
Yeah.
That I've actually been like, right, this is something that I want to do.
If you'd have said I was going to marry a pig farmer and fall in love with pigs, I wouldn't have agreed, put it that way.
It's David's childhood memories of his granddad's farm that fuels his passion to create the same for his family.
Every weekend, like summer holidays, I was just there. You know, whether we was off going to shows, it was just the environment that you wanted to grow up in. There's woodlands, there were fields to go out and camp in, and obviously the livestock was there as well. So yeah, best part of my life spent down there.
It did wind down. When his grandfather died, they kind of... you stopped doing anything then, didn't you, for a while? So you restarted
back
up with your dad.
We literally wound it all the way back to just free pigs, just so my dad could...